You are listening to another Always Moto production. The Always Moto podcast with your host, David Hogan. This show contains information about injuries to riders competing in AMA Supercross, AMA Motocross, MXGP, OzPro MX, and other international moto events. The information discussed may be unsettling to some listeners. It might be incomplete or based on medical opinions due to riders tending to hide the details of their injuries. We are here to explain the information and increase injury understanding and visibility for the fans. There might be coarse language and the odd stuff up along the way. If any of this offends you, turn us off right now.
I'd like to remind you that he is not a doctor.
But I am a physiotherapist, and this is a very, very special episode of the Always Moto podcast. This is episode 35. I'm your host, David Hogan. Welcome to the Always Moto podcast. We are in the depths of the clinic throwing strapping tape anywhere it will stick. As always on the show, we'll be going through all things injuries in moto because hashtag injuries are a part of moto. Now, today's show will not be necessarily our usual format with the emergency department, Dave's diatribe and all those good parts and whatnot that we usually put on for you guys. This is a very dedicated episode just to our interview with Aldon Baker. As many of you will have seen, we dropped some teasers earlier this weekend, a couple of days ago, to try and get you guys enticed to check out the Always Moto podcast because we felt that this episode warranted your attention. So you should be listening to this episode all the way through. Aldon was an extremely good guest. But let's jump through a couple of things first before we get into the interview with Aldon. We are obviously putting through this show with the support of a few people now, which is fantastic. So let's jump into those couple of people that are supporting the show. We now have Polar Australia on board, which most of you will know who do anything in moto and training, and particularly as you'll hear with Aldon, you need to track your heart rate and all those other good parts that can come along with those multi-purpose fitness training watches nowadays. But Polar Australia is on board and supporting the Always Moto podcast, and they have actually released a brand new fitness and well-being watch, the Ignite 3. This is their very best offering to date in this field. It's the lightest watch you'll find at 35 grams. It's their slimmest watch. It's their best GPS watch with dual band GPS features. So keep an eye out for that one. It's available now. It's only dropped a couple of days ago. It's a very sleek watch and it's a very well lit screen and very easy to see. They're actually using some phone technology on these screens now to improve that quality there as well. So check out the Ignite 3. But some other big news from Polar Australia that's happening very, very soon. Obviously, today's date, we're dropping this episode on the 14th of November, Aussie time. But on the 21st of November through to the 28th of November, Polar Australia is having a very big sale. Check out their website. There'll be a link in our show notes and you'll see some of those links on our socials in the coming days to prepare you to get onto that sale, to help you save some money on these products that you will be using or should be using all the time. They've got up to 33% off their products with this sale, but specifically that might be of interest to us moto people is the Polar Grit X Pro. They're going to have 10% off it, which is one of their high-end multi-sport heart rate fitness watches. And they also have 20% off all H10 heart rate sensors, which is that chest strap. It's their highest quality one on their list. And they're going to have 20% off that specific heart rate sensor. So check out that sale. It's from the 21st of November through to the 28th of November. And the link, like I said, will be in the show notes. Please use our link. It will help support Always Moto and show that they have made a good choice in supporting the Always Moto podcast. So please use the link that we have available to get a purchase and update your fitness training apparatus and ensure that you're getting all the data you possibly can from that session that you're putting in all that effort into. We also have slant board, guys. Remember that one we talked about last week? We have a slant board affiliate deal with them where they are offering us a 10% discount for all Always Moto podcast listeners by using the Always Moto 10 code, which will be also linked in the show notes as well. It's a simple piece of equipment. It's a slant board. You can help use your improve your squats so you can get a better range of motion in those squats or lunges or whatever else you can come up with to do on top of that board on that slant to help make your legs stronger for the improve your standing technique on the bike. And that code again is always Moto in lowercase at checkout. Again, link in the show notes, and you'll also help with us by following that link, not just Google searching people. Don't just Google search. Please use the link in the show notes so that we can get that credit as such for our sale through the site so that we can help keep having these guys on board with us to support the show. It's fantastic. We've got two people on board now supporting the Always Moto podcast that we've been talking about for a while now, and we're hoping to bring you some more in the coming weeks. We just got some few negotiations going on. Hopefully, we can get some more companies that are very specific and products that I trust and I've used myself. I don't want to just bring you anybody onto this show and just take the money. I have to believe in them, and I have to be specific to Moto or in the fitness and physical performance or, you know, injury prevention side of things. So we're looking forward to bringing on some extra people here shortly. As always, we've still got the Always Moto podcast merchandise, the t-shirts available. They're $25 plus postage and handling in Australian dollars. We have an international dropship option available now. So we've got the US-based listeners can purchase that, and we'll get that through there. So the postage will be much cheaper now. Sorry for those listeners that had some higher priced postages back in the day, but we've sorted that out now. I've got an option to print them locally for you guys in the US. But hit us up, send us an email at alwaysmoto2019@gmail.com, put t-shirt order in the subject line, and we'll send through those details for payment. We're doing payments via PayPal, and we'll organize delivery and all that sort of good stuff. Now, as the last thing here as well, before we jump into this interview, if you can support the show in any way, you can always send a donation to Always Moto PayPal account. Drop a message or a question in that notes. Any amount will do. There's a link in our bio on our Instagram or on our social feeds there, and also in the show notes to get to that Always Moto PayPal donation section. And we can then read out those questions live on the show. So please send us a donation. It will help keep the lights on here at the Always Moto podcast, which has been growing every episode, which is fantastic. And look, let's talk quickly about this interview. I really appreciate it. I reached out to a lot of my contacts on social media to help support and promote this show. And I really appreciate the response that I've had from everybody that I've reached out to. Thank you for reposting that teaser video that I popped together a couple of days ago. Everyone who supported it, and now because of all those listeners that are now listening to this actual episode here as we're talking, I appreciate that that's been the case. And I really appreciate you supporting a small guy building his way into this industry here in this media game, and putting out this awesome podcast that we're trying to do for you guys and bring some different content that might not be necessarily asked in this light. Obviously, everyone's heard from Aldon Baker and other riders, but not necessarily in this light that we're looking at it from the fitness and industry side and injury side of things, not industry, injury side of things. So we're trying to bring you some different information. So hopefully you're enjoying it, but we really appreciate the support that everyone has given us. Now, onto the Aldon Baker interview. This was an awesome opportunity to sit down with Aldon. I asked him for 30 minutes to talk about his pre-season training program that he's currently putting his five riders through. Now, he's got Christian Craig as a newcomer. He's got Malcolm Stewart returning, Aaron Plessinger returning, Cooper Webb returning, as many of you have seen and heard about that little breakup and reuniting, and also continuing on with the program is RJ Hampshire. And they're the five guys specifically under Aldon. He obviously has the 250 program, which he's not directly responsible for, but run out of his Baker's factory property location there in Florida. But we wanted to get some information about what he does preseason. Now, like I said, I asked him for 30 minutes. By the time we had a few dropouts because there was a hurricane occurring in the area, so the weather over in Florida wasn't fantastic, and we'd gather the signal on his Wi-Fi, just kicked him off a couple of times. So bear with us towards the latter end of this interview. There's a couple of times he drops out, and we've had to sort of trim the audio to sort of match up so we could restart those conversations that we lost him for. So stick around for those bits, but he gets some really good stuff out. but he gave me way more than 30 minutes. It's almost an hour that he was on the phone for, and I really appreciate that because we dive into a few good topics here, not just in terms of, you know, the basic stuff that's going on there, but, you know, he's talking about some specific things with why he uses lactates as his measures for testing, why he uses body weights as well to prove a day's efforts, not just calories, which is a very simple measure. He's gone a bit more specific into that. And also how he adjusts his program and how he makes up time in his program for things that might happen that cause him to lose some effort periods along the way. So it's an extremely interesting interview. I had an absolute ball listening to him and getting to talk to him. It's probably a bit of looking at your hero sort of thing. He's a very, obviously been around for a long time, and we've known him for a long time in the industry of being the trainer to be with, and to actually get to sit down and talk to him was pretty cool. I've got to be honest, it was really cool. And we're hoping they'll be able to do some more things with Aldon over the next few months as the season progresses, and then their transition between Supercross and Motocross and how that all works for them, and so trying to get some more info from him along the way. So there should be more stuff from him with Always Moto in the near future, hopefully. So here's the interview, guys and girls, that you've all been waiting for. Appreciate you listening to the Always Moto podcast. Don't forget to check out those sponsors of Polar Australia and Slantboard Guy. And also buy your t-shirt so you can rock that Always Moto t-shirt at your next race event. But here's the interview with Aldon Baker. All right, joining us on the Always Moto podcast today, it's a pretty special guest. He's one of the more well-known trainers in our industry, and probably, I would say, definitely the most winningest or successful trainer in our industry. He's from the Baker's Factory. It's Aldon Baker. Welcome onto the show, Aldon.
Well, thank you, David. I appreciate it, man, and appreciate the kind words.
No, look, I think you've earned that, to be honest. That's pretty much, you've been the one around probably the longest and definitely the most successful. And obviously now with this Baker's Factory program that you've got, it's a pretty impressive thing that to put your name to and be the face of. So, you know, you deserve all the credit.
No, well, thank you. But as you know, in this sport, man, you know, the results are everything. And obviously, yeah, man, it's been an amazing 22 years. And, you know, definitely that's been incredible. But, man, we got to keep it going. So there's always a challenge ahead, man.
Yeah, exactly. It never ends, really, does it? There's always another race coming up. So,
right.
Well, let's jump into all this. We've got some questions here just to sort of talk about where you guys are up to with pre-season and what sort of goes into it for you guys. But I gather at this time of year, this is probably either the busiest and maybe the most critical part of your time with the guys as the trainer. Is that how you see this point in the year for you?
Yes, David, that's correct. I mean, for sure. You know, it's the preseason, and it's, you know, everything we can do to prep the guys before they go into racing. So for sure, the busiest and the most, what I call, full on with the athletes, for sure.
Yeah, I like, this is like with our season, the way it goes from race to race so quickly, there's not really time to rebuild anything from a physical, you know, performance side of things. So this time of year, it's where all that hard effort goes into, isn't it, to be able to maintain that through the year then too?
Yeah, correct. And it's about the only time where we try and get the least amount of distractions, you know, where the guys have to travel and even that's a challenge. I mean, even this weekend I've got Cooper's in Paris. Yep. You know, so there's still odd things that pop up, but I try and utilize the time that they're not having to travel or with, you know, having a lot of commitments, to try and get the most out of the preparation so that we're ready to go, you know, the first week in January.
Yeah, definitely. So what is the sort of point that you try and start this preseason from? Like in our industry, obviously there's the contract changeovers for teams and all that sort of stuff happens around that 1st of October. But is that too early, or is that like sort of where you start to aim for this to begin from? Like, I think you've started this program this year only sort of 2 weeks or so ago. Is that about what I saw online and stuff from the guys' socials?
Yep. Yeah, no. And look, typically it's the 1st of November when we do jump back into the training. You know, when you look back, you always work after the last race, which is outdoors, and then the guys do need obviously a break. And then you've got to tie in also with when you can get all the equipment, you know, the for Supercross. So you've got to be aligned with when the teams can provide equipment for them. And then we've got to give them a certain amount of time to rebuild all these Supercross tracks. So, you know, I have three of them and they typically take about a week each to be built. So I'll start the 1st of October building tracks. And then, you know, if all goes well, like it did, then after 3 weeks, we then jump into where we, you know, start at least getting into some riding. But during that period, the guys have to go to California and still, you know, start getting some of the new stuff, you know, set up and at least get their bikes pretty much to what they remember from the previous season so that those things can be built and then be shipped out to the facility here in Florida. So there's a lot of little logistics that need to come together. So, you know, you try and give the guys as much of a breather as possible before they dive back into it. And then you balance it out from there. But pretty much, you know, 1st of October is when really things for Supercross start going, you know, mm-hmm. between the riders, the team, and then me prepping for the basically that 1st of November start.
Yeah, I think you just definitely answered that part about being the busiest too. Like obviously all that prep that you just talked about in terms of tracks and team changeovers and gear getting to the facility is busy. But you sort of went to something there too that I thought I might just ask about is that gap between season and starting this. Is there a date, like a period of time that you like to see the guys have as a break dedicated and then before they start jumping back into some just, I gather, some maintenance cycling rides or anything like that to before they get to that 1st November? Is there a couple of weeks? Like, do you aim for two or three? What's your number there?
David, it's pretty much two, you know, weeks that they can, and I wish it was more, but it just...
you lose too much if it's longer.
Yeah, so they definitely get... where I tell them, you know, like take 2 weeks off where I don't, you know, you don't, if they wanted to lay in bed for 2 weeks, they could do it if they wanted to. But normally the guys will, you know, go on a holiday with their family or do something or regroup. And then after 2 weeks, we start getting back into cardio. And then you at least need those next 2 weeks of cardio before we start getting into riding again, you know, because you don't want to go just cold into riding a motorcycle again. You know, that's never the best. So, you know, they off the motorcycle, the goal is to have 4 weeks, but really from training it's only two. Weeks. Yeah, so it's not a lot.
No, it's not. They definitely don't get much time off in this sport compared to, say, you know, others. They have a much longer break in like NFL or something. So yeah, it's a bit of a bit of a quick turnaround. But so then obviously this phase starts, if you start that training, you know, 1st of November, say, like you just indicated, how long there's an intense phase for this preseason. How long is that for you before you then would say hit that taper into round one?
You know, so the goal is I try and utilize the, you know, basically the November and all of December, but when you put in the holidays, it's that adjusts things anyway, you know, like Christmas Day.
Yep.
New Year. So when I look at it, I'll only get probably 6 weeks total of solid training. The other little pieces really is you're lost with, you know, holidays, which you don't get around. And then also, you know, the odd weather delay and I'll give you an example in December, early December, they're all got to be in California for what they call Felt Media Day, where get all their pictures ready for that, so they go missing a little bit there. So when you incorporate all the days that they're not able to actually put in training, then you know you lose a certain amount. So, you know, I look at the schedule and then I look at the plan with what I have available. But overall, to answer your question, it's probably a good 6 weeks that's it in preparation before, you know, you start tapering off and leading up to the first race, which that is typically right around just after Christmas anyway. And they make that transition after then anyway towards California. So
yeah, so they'd be all moving out there then, wouldn't they? Like it's a bit of a busy week, that first week of January, I gather. So
exactly. And then they've got to run in their race bikes and all that. So that whole, system, you know, is definitely a lot more mellow. So it's almost like a natural taper, because you, it's not like you could do much more with it anyway.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah, you're forced into that situation. So yeah.
Correct.
Awesome. Well, what about like this? You've obviously been doing this for quite some time now, and you said, I think before we hit record, was about 22 years that you've been in this industry doing training for pro riders. Is this preseason Correct. Look anything like the preseason in terms of what you're riding out for a program as that you did at that very first time back with Ricky Carmichael all those years ago?
Yeah, no, it's evolved a lot since Ricky. I mean, you know, that just the racing and the overall training is evolved a lot. The biggest thing that I've seen is the difference with I've got putting good guys together. So if I give an example, when I started with Ricky back in the day, it was more very individual.
Yep.
And everyone trained alone. So it was really, you could actually almost push a lot more and add a lot more load because they weren't getting pushed automatically like I see the group now. So lately, since I've been able to put good guys together, there's no way I think they could cope with the load that I used to have. But so it kind of condenses a little bit, but the intensity is a lot better, if I can put it that way.
Yeah. So, so you're saying that like the overall, like maybe, no, all good. A couple of technical difficulties there, guys and girls. But yeah, Alden's back on the line. So he was just going through that the load and the intensity is probably the different point of, you know, the program this year than say 22 years ago. But so you're basically saying that this time around for the guys that are on the program, you know, Cooper, Aaron, Christian, Malcolm, those guys, that they're doing less, maybe say in the gym, or less miles on the bike, but they're probably just more intense on the track, on the actual moto. Is that what you're sort of getting at there with the training program?
Yeah, David, that's great. I mean, everything is obviously all in, you know, you line everything towards the riding, you know, and your riding fitness and your riding intensity. So, you know, it is good to see now that you're able to put, you know, good guys together. You can gain those, I'd say, get those gains a little bit easier than if the guy was all on his own.
Okay. You know?
So it's, but that's where it starts. I always, you know, on the program, I always look at, you know, I've got to get to at least where I know they're capable of a really high intensity for at least two solid motos, you know, which is, I weighed up as basically 22 minutes,
yep.
You know, so that's what you want to aim for in the training is like, okay, if I can get the guys at a high end and good speed and great consistency for that amount of laps, then we're pretty much looking good. So the goal is to head towards that, the cycling, the running, the, you know, the other cardio workouts, rowing, ski erg, all the other little pieces,
mm-hmm.
all are just links to help balance that out, you know,
help them achieve that consistency of the cardio over the 22 minutes.
Exactly. And then if you have kind of like today, we had a bit of a delay because of some rough weather, then I've got to adjust the intensity, which I'm trying to get out of cardio instead of, because I know I would have missed it from the motorcycle stuff. So you're constantly balancing, but the plan is ultimately to get towards that, you know, the riders being able to maintain at least that so that they can go racing, you know.
Yeah, and so I'm guessing what I'm hearing then today, they probably were all moaning and groaning that they're having to put in more effort on the cardio machine rather than the motorcycle.
Yes, yeah. So because something, I mean, these guys are racers, they motorcycle guys, so it's not like they just love the cardio part, you know.
No.
That just balances out the training that we need in order to gain that fitness. And then when you add the strength stuff, you know, the strength training is kind of individual because each guy's a little bit different in their strengths and weaknesses. So although I have to try and do, you know, the strength training as a group, but I will balance out that training with areas that I feel like obviously that
all of them need, but then there are specifics for guys that maybe have a little bit of a weak, you know, weakness in certain areas where they'll be doing a little bit extra in those kind of areas. So, yeah, that just adds that other little piece that you've got to make sure you are monitoring and adjusting accordingly.
Yeah, I think I had that a question a bit later on for us, but I'll jump in it now because you sort of touched on it. But you've got a couple of guys that are obviously a different stature, you know, Malcolm to like Cooper, like they're two different people physically, in, you know, to look at height-wise, bone structure, muscle mass, and obviously then going to adapt to those strength sessions very differently and potentially, you know, put on a lot of bulk or none, you know. So do your correct programs for those guys, because you've got like, I think it's five, isn't it, this year that you got working with you?
Yeah.
Are your strength programs like essentially the same, just different, like same exercise, say, like you're all going to do just first top off my head, chest press, say, right? We're all doing chest press today, but Malcolm's going to do a higher weight with more reps, and Cooper's going to do a smaller weight, sorry, a higher weight, more reps, and so on and so forth to target those different physical body types, or what do you do at that point for those variances that you're trying to work around?
Yeah, and that's a good question, David. But it starts with, so when I start with an athlete, so I obviously take measurements, see where he's at, see where his mobility is, see if he has any areas that, you know, from injuries, what he's capable and all that. So I have a pretty decent idea where everybody is at. But the biggest thing too, and you're right, is that each guy has a different structure. And like a guy like Malcolm, I mean, and even Coop, you know, we constantly having to watch, you know, weight gains, you know, that's a tough one. I mean, it's very individual, but it is what it is. So, you know, getting bulk in the gym is not going to help me at all, especially with those guys. So with them, I'm not a believer actually across the field of being on such heavy weight. I'd rather change their workouts, like specifically with them, to a lot lighter weight, more repetitions. So we're still getting that, what I call fatigue training, which is good for them on the motorcycle. But also we'll utilize a lot more combination workouts where they're doing more of a motion. So it also adds a little bit of that cardio side, so that they're actually burning a bit of calories too. And then I'm also a big believer in band workouts, because I feel like you can't damage anything with bands, but you can't really make massive muscle gain. But it is fatiguing, and it is great for keeping the specific areas strong, and also mainly to prevent against injury. You know, I feel like the gym stuff is more of a injury prevention scenario than anything else, to be honest, unless a guy has a massive weakness. But typically, by the time I get, you know, down the line, and we're in the, you know, later in 450 class, it's not like that's their first ever, you know, strength training workout or whatever. They pretty much have done a decent amount. Yeah, exactly. So they've pretty much come to you with, you know, all having done different sort of scenarios or exercises. And then I've got to kind of navigate through that and find out, you know, depending on what I see with weaknesses and strengths, and adjust accordingly. And then the other big thing is, you know, I do have to keep them as a group. You know, we don't have enough time in the day where I could individually do each guy in the gym. So
yeah,
I've got to be mindful of that on how creative I get in the gym, which, you know, to give an example, I change the gym. It changes every week.
So it's not the same. You do make that big differences all the time.
Yeah. Now I find that that's critical, because then I can kind of rally through multiple different exercises that, yeah, maybe this week it's not perfect for Malcolm, but it's still, he's going to get something out of it. But it may be aligned for more, let's say, Coop. And then, you know, I'll keep in mind that, okay, Coop's going to miss a session going off to Paris this week. Mm-hmm. So then I'll, you know, then it'll be switching to where it sort of favors more like a, you know, a Christian or a, you know, Malcolm in a way. But
yeah.
And adjustment of weight is very individual. And the way I work through that without getting complicated is, you know, the guys have got to meet their certain reps. And if it's slightly lighter, let's say for, or it's maybe a little bit under, like, or give you an example, let's say Malcolm can do this exercise specific, like a squat, a little easier than, you know, what Aaron can do,
yep,
then, you know, Malcolm will do more repetitions. Okay. You know, so it balances, and that's probably the best, because like I said, it's never perfect when you do have a group. There's huge benefits to having a group, and that's why I feel like they push each other. Yeah. The training's a little bit more fun. The longevity out of everything I feel is really good, but there are areas where you just have to give up a little.
Yeah, you know? Fair enough. And too, like there's only so many things you can do for a group of five. So, and in a short space of time when you're trying to make the best for everyone. So yeah, that would be difficult on different days to come up with the right mix. So I don't envy that part of your job at all. That would be the challenge, to make sure they're all engaged and enjoying it and progressing. So yeah, that'd be difficult.
Yeah, no, that's why I say, like, I've got my hands full when I have five guys. It's everything I have to monitor all of this, you know, and at least, you know that I'm making the gains that we need to make, you know.
Definitely. So on those gains and sort of on that weight sort of talk there about, you know, getting specific for the right rider at the right time with the weights. When you do start out these programs, and you sort of touched on it before about testing them for, you know, previous injuries and range of motions, is that day one for you at this point in the preseason, like to do like a testing day? And then what do you do test for at that point? Like, is there a couple of specific tests you would use and then reuse to say at the end of the 6 week preseason test to say, yes, we achieved this bit, we've got to this point that we wanted you at, you know, to be hopefully competitive, you know, come round one?
Yeah. And David, that's a good question. I mean, I try and get as much information in the beginning. I know before we start training, they're fresh. They're, you know, I mean, everything is pretty much ground zero in a way. Mm-hmm. It is a little bit different to a new guy, like in the case with Christian, you know, because then I have no information on him.
Yeah.
So I'll want to run a little bit more, and that's, you know, including the standard preseason blood testing to get a base to understand where they are in a rested point, you know, because it's difficult down the line to do blood tests when you're in training. You know, you're going to get a lot of false sort of scenarios with that, but at least preseason, it's to make sure that we've got the base blood work. And then I'm more into the lactate testing, to see what a rider's capabilities are. I'm not a big believer in VO2 because I feel like it doesn't align, or it's not needed for motorcycle racing. Now, if they were a cyclist or a runner or a swimmer, I'd say that is huge, because that's going to show their capability cardio-wise, but not for motorcycle racing. I feel like that's unnecessary, and I can get better values that are more specific to each guy with lactate testing. So
yeah, fair enough.
I'm a big believer of that. And there again, like in the case of like a new guy like Christian, you get that, but that's all you have. So that's your base settings. That is something that you would want to check again. But to me, it's not critical, because you ain't got any choices. You know, so when you get to the end and they're going to go racing, it's in a way, it could be detrimental mentally if you run another test and that's maybe not the ideal test.
Okay.
Because,
yep.
So I kind of pick my battles with that. And if I find that we have a situation where there's a day where, you know what, there's no riding, or it fits in and I know they're fresh and that, then I might throw that test back at them. But it's not ideal, I feel, because really, if for some reason, I mean, I feel like you're definitely going to, I mean, you're going to make improvements just on complete, just looking at the program, when you've built up more and more and more intensity and laps, it's going to get better. You know, I've never had a guy go backwards, to be honest. But you've also got to watch that. You don't want the mentality to change. You know, he's got to go racing matter what. Even if he's not ready, it's not like you can call and say, hey, can you guys move the schedule? This guy ain't ready. You know,
that'd be an interesting phone
call. It's going to happen. Yeah, you know, and that's something, you know, it's funny because sometimes we laugh when I first watched them in the first week of riding, and I'm like, dang it, man, maybe we need to get that schedule changed to like February, you know, and they will start laughing, you know, like, anyway, but you know, my point is that you also want to be realistic at what they have to go and do. You know, it's not like there's any choices. So you've got to watch that a little bit. But typically seeing improvements is something I want to see on the motorcycle. And I do have what I call consistency ratios on how consistent they are lap by lap and also how much they can take load-wise on a motorcycle. That's always your two major sort of guidelines, you know. The rest, I mean, even the cycling and the cardio, that improves anyway because you're doing a lot more of it and it's, you know, becomes, you know, part of it. So
you make an interesting point there about that, the psychology part about not retesting right before because it might, you know, break the person before their season starts.
Like, yeah,
it's I hadn't thought of that because like I suppose in moto they are a bit fragile in the sense of the psychology and, you know, this guy's beating me and I can't get him on this lap, or, you know, he's beating me in the gym everywhere. I don't want to know that he's massively better than me physically before I go and try and race him for the money. You know, I hadn't thought of that point. It's really, you've been on.
Well, it's true, David. And that's why I know in earlier when you're some of the things that I read, I think one of the things we were going to chat about was, you know, having like a, you know, PR record of for like rowing or something, you know what I mean? Which you honestly don't want that because you're going to get certain athletes that just gravitate that they'll love the rower, or another guy's a great, just automatically better cyclist than another one. So you got to be careful that you don't want to show that, oh, wow, you know, this guy just blew the socks off that, but not everyone can do it, because now you're like, dang it, he's not going to deal with this too well. But they're all competitive guys and they're racers, you know. So it's bad enough per se that every guy will have their bad days on the track, and how you navigate that is also important. But I kind of sit down with the group also before we all start training and get them to understand that not every day is going to be a good day for any one of them. And also some guys gravitate better to a particular track than others. And, you know, we have three supercross tracks. So I do find, you know, so I think with them knowing that, you know what, the goal here is to use each other to be better and to be pushed. That's going to make each of us better. But then obviously when we go racing, it's all into what we do it on race day, and that's our race craft, and pretty much, you know, what you do from the start, you know, to the end of the race. Yeah,
definitely. Like, because I was just thinking as you're talking about all that, like that they're obviously knowing the lap times when they're on the track for the days, and that's probably enough of the, the beat down than having in the gym. Yeah, all right, 2K on the rower, I'm fifth out of five.
Yeah.
Like that would be probably hard enough. It's hard enough knowing that you're fifth out of five on the track that day, let alone going into the gym later in the afternoon or whatever. And and there it is too. Oh crap, I'm terrible. They wouldn't need to know that. Do they watch, like I've seen some of your some of the videos and stuff on you guys in the past with like having some heart rate data sort of on screens and stuff. Are you still doing that sort of thing? Because I assume then with the five guys, they'd be monitoring their heart rates over different activities that they're doing as well, and going, oh, he's better than me on that same amount of effort and whatever. Like there's so many points that they could be competitive on if you have that stuff with the data.
You know, I try and limit that. Like each guy has their own, you know, heart rate zones, which, you know, when they get the program, you know, at the beginning of the week, it shows all their individual heart rates. And they, as long as they're sticking to that, which that's downloaded each day, and I get to see that. But I don't really swap out each one's heart rates. You know, I think that's very personal, and they understand too. I mean, just if you look at, you know, a young guy compared to a guy that's more of a veteran, you know, their heart rates are different naturally.
Yeah, and that's the natural physiology changes, isn't it? So
exactly. So I don't put that out there. I mean, there's only a few times where we've done like group spins and then it comes up on the screen, and it's more just for me to make sure that each one's kind of in their zone, because that's an area where they can kind of almost slacken off a little, you know. but on the motorcycle, I don't have any problems with that. And I, you know, obviously, I get to see that, and you know, I keep that pretty much between me and each individual, you know.
Yeah, definitely. And on that, just a little side note here for you on the Polar, because I know you guys use Polar for all your heart rate tracking. I was actually talking to a guy from Polar Australia yesterday. They're going to start doing some support of the podcast here, and he actually
awesome.
it was actually quite amazing. He actually knew who you were and that you had come up in multiple of their business meetings about the data that you were gaining from the use of the product. And he actually was like, "Oh, make sure you say hi to him. It's pretty impressive what he does with our products." And I was like, "Wow, it's sort of awesome that our sport in the training sense is crossing over through this, through this training for them in their marketing and stuff about how to use it." So that was pretty impressive.
No, it is. And look, Polar's been there from the beginning, with me. So, and man, I have so much data from early, and what's so impressive is their systems have got just kept on proving, on giving you more and more into it. I remember when I'd have to break down the heart rates and then minus all the unusable time, and it would take me for forever to get through. Yeah. Actually, thank God in those days I was only doing like one guy or maybe two. But when you got full on, and now it automatically does that. So gosh, it just makes my life a lot easier. And then Polar have been kind enough to let me utilize their sort of like their team docking station system.
Yep.
Which that's so cool because, in our sport, unfortunately, that the heart rate monitors take a massive abuse on a motorcycle.
So
if you don't have to have that on your wrist and it's all in the actual transmitter, which I get to utilize, it's huge, man. That makes a big difference. And then it's quickly downloaded and we are good to go. So thanks to them, they make my life a lot easier, that's for sure.
Yeah, and they definitely obviously get so much data that you're using every day. So yeah, it's an amazing product there.
Yeah.
But I was just thought it was amazing that they knew exactly who you were, because it's not too often that you can bring up somebody in the moto world to a non-moto person and they go, oh yeah.
Yeah.
It was pretty awesome. So that was cool.
No, that's cool that we're making inroads into the bigger picture too, which, as I say, it's an important tool for our sport for sure.
Definitely, definitely. Now, what about the negative side of our sport is the injuries, right? What are you doing at this point in this year to either test or to confirm sort of a baseline of where the person's at, like the rider's at, to then say, all right, they did get injured, say, in round six, whatever, and we know that by 4 weeks later, they're actually back to a level that is suitable from what you tested earlier to then send them back.
Yeah, David, and that's, injuries are always that, ugly side of the deal that you struggle with. I mean, look, we always, hope and pray that the guys can get through without any injuries, but there are tip overs and it's going to happen, and some are worse than others, but I think the three things that I analyze, the most important injury is obviously like a concussion or something, or they bang their head. That's the one that, look, they do their preseason baseline testing for that. Mm-hmm. And then that part, if they ever do have a crash or they bang their head or they're not quite right, they automatically have to go and do that retest, and they are then under a doctor or professional person's care in that area. And actually in Florida we have some really good doctors that can check them and do a scan and all the rest. So that's nice. The one that you dread the most, and I wouldn't say you mess around with any injury, but that one you really, that you don't take any gamble with, And then the others, the main things that I try, and especially when I look at strength training, because I look at strength training as probably the best preventative. The strength training and then also yoga. I'm a big believer in yoga, and I feel like the stretching that I have them do each morning naturally helps flexibility, and it really helps if they do tip over with the way their body reacts. So I'm a big believer in, a big believer in that. And then I also, I do feel like knee injury and shoulder injury is probably one of the other main twos.
Yep.
They
are from my data. Yep.
So I try and focus on everything that helps with knee stability and strength, and also shoulder, stability and strength. Those are the areas that, like, I'll always highlight in my strength training to make sure that each guy, okay, are we doing everything we can to be in a better way to be preventative of an injury, you know? Mm-hmm. And then from there, you know, you carry on without trying to make it too complicated. Obviously, when I start with a guy, we part of the baseline and everything is to itemize and go over any injuries that he's had and kind of where he's at going forward and what's our plan to hopefully make that better, you know?
Definitely. And so then with Christian being a new starter to your program, and this is sort of a question I wanted to sort of see about with the injuries and that based on like a comparison to like the stick and ball sports where they would do exit medicals from teams and prior to contracts being put in place and then to confirm that they can actually go ahead and do what they said they were doing. They're not coming into the new team as such, you know, with a pre-existing thing that's going to then impact that you know, the contract being fulfilled, let's say. Did you, with Christian coming over, did you get a chance to do anything like that, like a pre-medical or something? Or did he signs with the team because he signs with the team and then day one you get to work out where he's at?
Yeah, the thing is, once the team signs, you know, the rider, I'm left with, okay, hey, we've signed him, you know, he has his number, start connecting and get on it. So it's not like he's got much. Yeah, so those things just come along and honestly, you work from there forward. It's, you know, unless there was something ridiculously major or he rolled up towards you and he's already sort of got an injury, meaning, you know, like, oh man, I've just had ACL and you know, whatever or something, then you're like, okay, heck, how long ago? You know, then you dig a little deeper. But most times I've had a new guy, that's not the case, but you do go over their sort of pre-injury sort of career in a way. I'd say the one that comes to mind that was the worst was when Villopoto contacted me and he wanted to join in, and the concern, you know, he had had a horrible foot injury, ankle injury, and
that's right, he was torn in St. Louis at that point, before he came to you.
Exactly. And the problem with that, we were both not sure if that was something that he could actually ride a motorcycle properly with, so I had to take him to a special clinic that did a full test on that ankle mobility and had a few doctors look at that to give their best opinion on, hey, you know what, he's still going to be able to manage a motorcycle well. It's not going to be something that has ruined his career, because he was torn if he should take insurance money that he'd been paying for a long time and just that's it, or, you know what, am I able to do the job properly? But that was probably the one that we went backwards and forwards the most, and I mean, thank God that all actually worked out really well.
I was going to say, it turned out awesome, considering if you what you're saying there is he was thinking about taking an insurance retirement payout, that like it worked out in his favor not to.
No, exactly. No, it was close. He was just, it wasn't just a straight like, all right, heck, I'm ready to go. It was a little bit up and up. But that's, you know, those scenarios are the ones that you try and analyze. And the biggest thing is just to make sure you have an understanding that, look, can this guy actually do his job properly? You know, and not only for himself, but also for the team.
Yep.
You know?
Yeah, yeah. No, that's So it's awesome. I picked up there that you basically, you're using some, especially with that Villopoto example, you went and used some extra medical, sources to go and get a more professional opinion on it, because it's probably not something that you can, you know, say you qualified to look at accurately at that level for that, especially in Villo's example, like that was a pretty significant injury. So,
definitely. So those one-offs, the ones that you hope you never have to deal with, but every now and again in the sport, that's what pops up.
Definitely. You know? Yeah, no, look, that's interesting. It's always part of our sport, unfortunately, but yeah, like obviously it changes what you're doing at the beginning a little bit. And like, so yeah, the stick and ball example is you don't get that sort of history coming in. You just got to take it once you've got them signed. So yeah, it's, we do it differently in the motor world.
That is for sure. Yep.
Now I've got a couple of extra ones. Are we still all good with time? Where are we up to for yourself? How much?
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Let's
no problem.
Let's keep going then. So I've got a couple, just ones here that I put at the bottom of our question sheet that we organized beforehand. Now, how do you manage that sort of time when you lose time on things? Like, I'm thinking like along the lines of the guys, you've got five guys out on a cycle ride, but you know, flat tires happen on cycle rides probably more often than you'd like. How do you go about, like, especially in this preseason time, there's like maybe half that ride, you know, wasted, lost, because you've got to then get back, you cut a shortcut to get back to make it to the next part of your day. How do you make up that stuff, or can you? All right, okay. So another technical difficulty, but we're just jumping straight back in. So one of those questions about, you know, how you make up some time in this preseason when you have, if you've got five guys on a cycle ride, and then, you know, flat tires happen on these rides, unfortunately, probably more often than you'd like. How do you make up that? Because you're going to, at that point, you know, you're there repairing a tire, potentially it takes longer than you'd like. You have to cut that ride short to get back to make it to the next part of your training day. Can you make that up, or what are you trying to do to sort of alleviate those little issues of time loss?
Things you can't even be prepared for, and that does happen. You're right. So in that situation, it is a bit of a bummer because almost everybody suffers through that. I don't like to just say, hey, you guys carry on and we'll, because you never know when, you know, I do believe we still maintain as a team and we do stuff together, but to a limit. If it's just a quick bike tire change or something, then, you know, I have the stuff ready and pretty much I'm the guy that'll sort it out.
You're carrying the toolkit.
Yeah, well, I have a toolkit on every guy's bike. Actually, each guy's bike is housed at my place.
Okay.
They all come to my house, cycle from here, because then I can keep a bit better maintenance schedule and also monitor, like if a guy's tires are looking tired, you know, these athletes, it's not something they really monitor, but I will check on that and make sure that we're at least ahead of the game. So that helps.
Yeah.
But still, there are those occasions. In fact, the other day it was me that I caught something and the tire blew. Was it so? But I will at the end of the week, because when I look at training time, I have a plan for the week, and whatever I'm lacking there, that it will be tacked on to the following week.
Yeah,
in
right.
Some way or so. It's not that hard to balance that out. I mean, sometimes the less they know, the better. Like they don't know what I have, and then suddenly it'll be slightly longer ride, and they every now and I get the one saying, man, that was longer than normal. Is there
a little bit about that one.
I'll say, yeah, I'm making up for some stuff that I know that's coming. You know, that's not, you know, and then there's no questions. But you do have to adjust accordingly. And some days too, and I only really know it at the end of the week when I've balanced everything out. And that's the only kind of possible way of doing it. I used to do it day by day, but it's very difficult to then like rearrange and just and change, except especially when you have five.
Yeah.
So I just do it more at the end of the week, and you know, that might adjust things the following week with an extra, you know, 15, 20 minutes in cardio, or the guys will notice, you know, instead of a row being, you know, maybe 30 minutes, it's 35, or, you know, there's just ways that you can adapt to make sure that my numbers meet, you know, weekend and week out. So, and they typically, like I said, it's not anything that I've had really too much questioning over, but that's your only way of fixing those little issues.
Yeah, fair enough. It'd be hard to sort of catch up at times, but yeah, if you're doing a couple minutes here or there, they hopefully they don't notice too much, like you said, so they
that's
can
right.
Physically and mentally they're not going, Jesus, what's he doing to us today? So
that's right, you sneak it in there. So yeah.
And what about, but, like, what's a day in what's a heavy day for you guys in preseason? Like, how much cycling, how much bike time, how much gym time? Like, what's a heavy day for them at this point? Like, give the listeners an idea of what you're putting these guys through day to day at the moment.
Yeah, and look, it does vary, but I'd say the toughest days are Tuesdays.
Okay.
I call them Tough Tuesday.
Yeah.
And that's when I want to get the most out of the motorcycle, meaning the longest of the sessions. So give you an example. Look, we start with their, you know, they have their stretching, which they'll do at their house, and yep. Then we start with cardio, which can vary depending on the week.
Yep.
Anything from 30 to an hour initially if there's riding on the day, which let's say if we're talking about Tuesday, that's the case. And then they're out at the track riding. I do try and stick to limited time in between so that we don't make for long days, and also not to lose the track too much.
Yeah, so, moisture-wise from a riding point. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah.
And also with the amount of guys that I have, you know, I have a full-time track guy, but he needs as much time as he can possibly have to fix the track, you know, reasonably.
Like for the next day. So
the next day, yes.
Yeah, so he needs some daylight too.
Exactly. So, you know, I give them a 10-minute warm-up, which that's when they're allowed, they can do whatever, you know, they circle around thing, and that's the period when they can make adjustments with their mechanic. Mm-hmm. And then we start the schedule. And so on a Tuesday, they would start with as like a longer session, and that's probably about 15 laps initially.
Yeah.
At this point. And then I don't have much of a break between, and that's still out on the track. And then they'll go into either, well, definitely some shorter stuff, but I try and make up at least, you know, probably 20 to maybe 25 laps in that first session. And then I feel like we need to put water down anyway. They take a break, which is typically 45 minutes.
Yeah.
And then we come out and do starts. We practice starts before the bikes get too hot or, you know, too used up.
Yeah.
And then after starts, they start their second session, which is very similar, at least another 15, or later in the stage will be another 20 lapper, then a little break, and then the shorter stuff. And that either be, you know, shorter sprint laps, yep. You know, 3 to 4 laps, yep. Or even shorter laps. And the way, I mean, I always have a plan, but sometimes I'll adjust depending on weather. You know, if it's a colder day, I feel I can squeeze even more out of them. But if it's a hot day, like at the moment, it seems like it hasn't really tipped towards the cooler days. Then I've got to be a little bit careful, because I can read that they're right on that little rivet, you know, where it's, I'm not going to get the productivity that I would hope for, you know, depending on the situation. But on average, you know, a good 40 to 45 laps on a supercross track is about normal. And then after that, they take a break, and then we do the gym, and the gym is anything from 45 minutes to an hour.
Yeah, wow, there's a lot. So what's the measure that you get at the end of the day for like calories burned, or like is there another number that you're looking at to say that this was a big day? Like where's that compared to like a normal person going to the office? It's probably massively different, obviously, but
And you know, I'm not a big thing on the whole calorie, because each guy's different on
true what the whole physical makeup do. Conversation earlier, yeah.
Yes, you know, because I mean, look, the polar will tell me, and I mean, some days I'm like, oh my gosh, that seems ridiculous. But it's my way of checking how much calorie expenditure is how much weight they've lost at the end of the gym when I weigh them.
Yeah, right. Okay.
You know, I think, you know, I utilize that a lot, and I check them every time at the end of the gym, because then I can get an idea too of, I know where they were, and now we're looking at, okay, where are they now? You know, and and that to me is very relative to each one individual.
Yeah, that makes sense. So it gives me a
instead of, well, heck, you know, you burn up 3,000 calories. If I tell them how much they've supposedly burned, then it just gives them the mindset they can go home and eat whatever they want. And
that's which is what you don't want them to do.
What I do not want. So I'm very careful on that whole thing.
When you were saying too before about like on a warmer day or a cooler day, you do more or less, I'm assuming there's one guy that's the weatherman and tells you specifically whether you're over that marker. Which one of them is it out of the guys? So we just last dropout, hopefully, but we were probably playing havoc with the weather and stuff over there, so the signal's probably not that good. But Alden, you're saying about like on a hot day or a cool day, you would adjust the amount of laps, you know, for the guys depending on the scenario with the weather. I'm assuming there's one guy in your group that's probably the weatherman and is telling you specifically whether it's over or under a certain number, so that you know whether you're adjusting the extra laps or not. Is there one of those guys in your group?
Actually, David, I'm that guy.
Oh, okay.
I've been doing it long enough where I know, you know, the effects, especially in Florida, of heat, and also specifically Supercross. You know, you don't get a lot of breathing room, and it can be really, really warm. So I am mindful
And I can kind of look at each athlete and see how much sort of you can look in their eyes and how much the strain really is, and especially regarding heat, how much they're sweating.
Yeah.
So I need to be mindful with that and try and, once again, I want to get the most productive out of a session and not just beat the guys down. You know, there's no point in that.
Well, you still need them to turn up tomorrow and do it again, don't you? So
exactly. And then, you know, owning a facility makes you an instant weatherman. You need to be on point with what's coming, what's on radar, what's the heat index, because not only for the athletes, but also to try and, you know, fix the track and take care of that, and how much, you know, the water truck needs to be used to water the, you know, so there's a lot that goes into, you know, keeping the at the best possible way to get the best training out of them.
You definitely sound like you've become more than just a trainer these days with that whole facility now. Like, there's obviously so much more to it than just you hit your heart rate numbers today and we did your number of laps today. Obviously, there's so much that you've built into this by having the tracks, the staff, the, you know, the buildings, the gym, all that's probably gone in, exponentially increased your workload.
No, it does. And, you know, you're going to know me. I don't know when those machines need to be serviced, what goes into these. I mean, it's a lot. I mean, it still really is cool, but I would have never thought when I first went into it that there's so many pieces of trying to make that big old ship run well, you know. So it keeps me on my toes, that is for sure.
And despite all that, you somehow managed to find time to get involved with a new venture in the cycling world. You want to tell us a little bit about how you managed to get involved with that?
Well, David, you know, that's been a dream for the last, gosh, 4 or 5 years now, where I thought, man, it'd be so cool. Always, you know, bicycle's been integral in all my training and my background and everything. And I thought, man, you know how cool it would be to have your own, like, perfect bike, you know. And I've, you know, was blessed to be involved with Specialized for 22 years. But having my own bike was always there in the back of my mind. And actually, one of the partner that I have, his name's Alfredo. He was a guy that I kind of helped on the side, who's a top BMX pro. And He had a similar dream. He's come from Ecuador. And we were chatting years ago about, man, how cool would that be to have your own bicycle? And we spoke about it. And then he kind of went off and did a lot more research. And then when I'd meet up with him, we would chat more about it and look at the different logistics. Well, over the years, it developed to a plan to sourcing the right, you know, companies in Asia that make the best carbon and all the process. But it started off more as a nice dream, I'd say, and sort of a homework kind of package to look into it. Well, over that time, things developed, connections were made. We've, you know, had about two or three different prototypes that I would test on the side and look at, and then go back with ideas. But it actually comes full circle now, and we're actually going to launch this on the 15th of November. The name of the bicycle is El Carvi, and it's basically a combination of our two names, and you say it like Ferrari, El Carvi.
And, nice.
To us, it's our basically our Ferrari, you know. So
sounds cool.
A lot has gone into, you know, we're excited and you know, I always think to start off a bicycle, you need to have a really good road bike. And then our goal is to venture into gravel bikes and then into the mountain e-bike.
Yeah, right. So you're going to cover the whole range eventually.
That's the plan. And look, we're not, you know, there's going to be limited quantities. I think we're not just diving in because they are special and a lot has gone into them, and there'll be three versions that kind of align with, we've aligned ourselves with Shimano, and they're different three, you know, ETAP, you know, versions, you know, the electric.
Shifting.
So we kind of had to wait because Shimano on their 105, which is the lower model. They've only just brought out their new electric for that. And so finally now, like, are ready to, you know, and I'm talking, we're going to probably only sell 50 the initial run, and then the following year, you know, next year, the goal is 150 and so on. So it's not a lot of bikes that we want to offer, but I do believe that they are special, they are, and we'll go from there.
Oh, it's amazing that you can find the extra time. But yeah, it sounds like you've got that full passion project going there. So that's an awesome thing. And I'm surprised that you found time for it. But yeah, it's obviously a dream. So congratulations on getting it off the ground.
No, thanks. And I'm surprised we managed to also with the time that I have. But that's been a really awesome almost project. And then the other thing too is I want to align it with Baker's factory because that's actually where the bike will be assembled and actually shipped out of. So it's a little bit of a collaboration, which we're excited about.
You have to build another building out there or something for fabrication or something. What's going on there? Your property's getting multi-use now.
I know. Well, I feel like I've actually got the space. But I think as things develop, yes, there will be some improvements in a couple of things. So it should work out really, really cool.
No, yeah. Look, it sounds awesome. And I've seen some of the footage you've popped up on social media there of the images of the bike and that, and you on it. And it looks cool. So we'll have to see what it looks like when you drop more of it on the 15th.
Yeah, no, thanks, David. As I say, we're excited and looking forward to that part of it for sure.
No, awesome. And look, Alan, appreciate the time today, mate. And obviously with the weather and stuff and even all the dropouts still coming back around. So look, it's awesome to have you on the Always Moto podcast. Your insight's been fantastic. I really appreciate diving in deep on some of those things with the program at this point in the year. And look, good luck for the rest of the couple of weeks. Hopefully the guys can, put in the effort now to get the rewards later.
No, well, thanks, David. And as I say, man, I appreciate you and keep up the good work there with Always Moto. I do, check on it now that when you connected with me, I was able to link in and see that and hey, keep up the great work on your end. And I look forward to it also at some point popping over for a visit to Australia. My family live in Australia, although they're on the western side.
Oh, fair. I didn't realize that. Okay, yeah, no, awesome. No, look, you have to get over here one day, maybe with these other events we've got going on. But look, I'm hoping to catch up with some of you guys over in the States next year at some point. So we'll have to come and put faces to the names. So yeah, definitely.
Perfect. No, we look forward to that. But thanks for everything. And as I say, keep up the good work on your end too, mate.
We'll do. Awesome. Thanks, Alden.
All right. Take care. Cheers. Bye-bye.
All right, guys and girls, thanks for sticking around and listening to the Always Moto podcast. I thought I'd drop in after that interview there with Alden and all that great information that he gave us. I thought I'd drop in a little bit of an explanation around a couple of the things that he mentioned through the training side of things and see if we could just explain it or expand on it just a little bit further, because obviously there's some information there that he might have just sort of glossed over. So I wanted to just run through a couple of things on the VO2 max bit that he mentioned, the lactate threshold that he mentioned, and his consistency ratios that he mentioned. Now, he out and sort of touched on the fact that he doesn't like to use the VO2 max score in moto because it's not very specific. And it's completely understandable why he would come across with that, because the VO2 max is around your ability to use oxygen over the maximum oxygen your body can utilize during exercise. Now, for a cyclist who purely is just a cardio exercise, same with swimming or long distance running, it's a perfect measure and a good use of it. But in moto, where you're doing such high intensity activities, it doesn't translate as a good measure of what fitness is. So that's where he then came across with the blood lactate measures that he was talking about as well. And that's because the blood lactate is actually then it's the point during incremental exercise that lactate builds up in your bloodstreams. And the higher that level is that you can work towards, means the more intensity you can put into your training efforts and how long you can maintain a high output before that lactate builds to or goes beyond the point that you can sustain. So he's obviously trying to then increase that lactate point to be as high as it can be so that they can perform at a maximal effort in that sort of 20-minute moto of a supercross or a 30-minute plus two in a motocross round to be able to be under that and then repeat that. So also he's using that lactate then as a sign of recovery before they do the next thing. And that's why it's sort of done in incremental exercise blocks that they would test that. So this, like I said, this that VO2 max and the lactates are very different aspects of training, but they're very specific in some sports than others. And that's why Alden has leaned towards the blood lactate. It's nice to know what your VO2 max is, but it's not critical in this sense of moto and training for moto. So that's why he goes over to more that lactate measures. And it's something that's much easier to test too, the lactates. It's a little prick on the end of the finger, kind of like any, if anyone listening knows anything about diabetes testing, where they prick the finger, get a little bit of drop of blood, put it on a little strip, and then measure the glucose levels in the blood. It's done similarly. You're measuring just the lactate that's in the blood. You come out with millimoles scoring, and you can then tell how it's progressing along at different zones. Now, usually once you hit zone 3, it's gone up a lot. Zone 4, it's gone up even more. And zone 5, you're maxed out. And it sort of matches to those heart rate zones. So you're trying to move those along a bit further. And that's where he then also mentioned that each guy's heart rate zones is specific to them. So he's obviously adjusted those based on those blood lactate scores. So very interesting stuff that he's working through with his training program and utilizing all this data from his polar heart rate tracking stuff, but also he's going into blood testing. He's doing it himself, but he'd also get those done externally and get more counts done from full blood work panels, etc. So some interesting stuff. The consistency ratio is another thing that I think he's developed over time for the moto specific side of things, to judge the effort on track. So not just using the heart rate straps again for his zones and how long they were in a certain zone on the track, because as soon as you get, if anyone's ever actually used their heart rate strap on the moto in any intense sort of 20 minute ride or something, you'll notice that you in moto, your heart rate almost goes into that zone 5 straight away and stays there for pretty much the whole time. It's a little bit of the intensity. It's a little bit of being anxious and hyped up for the moto. But it's also then all the, in a race situation, you're obviously got all the action, people cutting you off, you trying to pass somebody, that jacks your heart rate up. It's not purely a cardio-based reason that your heart rate's elevated. There's other factors going into it, the adrenaline dropped into the body because you've just hit a massive jump or somebody's cut you off and you almost crash. So, the adrenaline spikes, that forces your heart rate higher. In this consistency ratio, he's talking about the time of each lap and how close they are every time they're on the track. So he's measuring every lap time and comparing it to a set lap time for that day. So they'll go out initially in that warm-up period that he talked about of 10 minutes. And then their first session, they'll get a lap time that is their best time. He's then comparing that every lap after that first time on the track to that lap time for every lap of the day and coming out with how much variance they had across that whole day as to whether they were slacking or whether they were very much putting in a massive effort and very close to each lap time every time on the track. And that's how he's telling his moto effort. So for everybody out there going, all right, I've improved my lap time by 5 seconds today, great. That's great in a one lap sense. Aldon is very much focused on consistent laps over the whole moto and repeated over each moto for, a motocross day. So moto one, moto two. He's very close. He wants everything to be exactly the same, one moto to the other. The effort is the same and the time is the same. So what you want to then take away from this, if you're thinking about how you implement this into your own training, is each lap on every day, at every time you go out to the track, you got to set something to begin with and stick to that time as close as you can across the whole day, and that will show whether your fitness is improving or not. So some basic take-home measures there for you. So something to think about when you go to the track next time. But like I said, that interview was awesome. I got a lot out of that. If anyone has any extra questions about that particular episode with Aldon there, please send us a DM on Instagram or send us an email through that alwaysmoto2019@gmail.com. Be happy to then try and answer those in subsequent shows or actually put them to Aldon again on our next time we talk to him and see if we can come around to some more information specific to those questions for you guys and girls. So please feel free to send those through to us and we'll get those answered as best we can. So just quickly before we go, just a reminder of those things that we're talking about at the beginning of the show. The Polar Australia sale is coming up on the 21st of November through to the 28th. Check out the link in the show notes to get those to get onto that site and get those deals available to you. Slantboard Guy has their very simple exercise equipment available that will help your training. Check out the link also available in the show notes and use the code ALWAYSMOTO10 to get your 10% discount. Sorry, I think it's just Always Moto. Check the show notes anyway. It's in there for that code. But it is all lowercase. I know that much for sure. Make sure that you are following us on social media to stay up to date with all things injury and moto. Search Always Moto and then follow and subscribe. Make sure you, if you haven't already, if you're a new listener to this episode because it's Aldon Baker and you thought that was going to be cool, if you'd liked what we did, make sure you subscribe to the podcast feed so you see what comes out next. If your podcast app allows, please leave us a rating. It helps us get more listeners and helps us keep bringing you more show content. So please like or subscribe and rate us as well. Don't forget to check out our written articles over on fullnoise.com.au. Some of you will have found the show from fullnoise.com.au. And this show is, we have other interesting articles that we do product reviews as part of our Always Moto inspections over there on that site, as well as our written versions of the emergency department before each round of the AMA Supercross. We did some for the World Supercross rounds recently, and we've got one coming up for the Oz Supercross rounds before Newcastle. We'll have some pretty cool content coming up after the Newcastle round. I'm going to be there on the ground. We're going to be trying to catch up with some of the Aussie Supercross riders and do some post-race interviews and whatnot. So some good content coming your way with that series in the next few weeks. But that's it for this show. It was a massive one. Thanks for listening. Remember, you've got to be smooth to be fast, because if you're not, I'll probably be seeing you deep in the emergency department. Maybe even the clinic, having strapping tape thrown at you wherever it sticks. Thanks for listening, guys and girls.